Hey guys, how's everyone feeling after lunch? I love the post-lunch session. Like really have to energize people back up. Well, thank you for coming. I am Kara Lewin, and you might notice my accent. So I am from the US. I moved to London about 10 months ago with Facebook. I've been with Facebook for a little over 4 years, and I'm currently a program manager on the Blueprint team at Facebook. Who here has heard of Facebook Blueprint? Great, I'm gonna educate you on it then. I'll talk more about it at the end of the presentation, but Facebook Blueprint is our educational arm for advertisers. So we have a couple of different training capabilities. So we have online courses, they're free self-paced modules. It's not just on advertising, it's also on unpaid initiatives too. And if you go to facebook.com/blueprint, I'll talk about it at the end. You guys can learn more about what we talk about today. Sound good? Perfect. And before we jump in, I know this session's title is Facebook and Instagram Best Practices, which we will be talking about. I wanna set the context that the first half of this presentation is going over what Facebook's about a little bit and our available tools and products. And then the second half is about how to best use them and a part on creative best practices, which I think will be really interesting for you guys. So hopefully this will be relevant. And lastly, in terms of questions, I know there's some burning questions out there. What we're gonna do, I'm gonna try and get through the whole presentation, and then I'm gonna be at the Facebook Workplace booth for about an hour and a half after this session. If you have specific questions, you're welcome to come and ask me anything you're thinking about. Amazing. So we like to start these sessions talking a little bit about Facebook's mission, because we did recently make a change in this. And what Mark Zuckerberg, I always refer to him as Mark, has confirmed our mission to be is giving people the power to build community and bringing the world closer together. So we have taken the responsibility and feel it's upon us to really help people build communities wherever they are and help bring people in different places closer together through our different tools and products. And for the last decade, Facebook's been focused on connecting friends and family, right? With that foundation, though, our next focus will be building the social infrastructure of a global community. And there's a couple of pillars with that. The first one is building supportive communities. So within the groups product, making sure that people are feeling supported within people that have similar interests to them. A safe community, you might have seen some of our features like the Amber Alert or the safety check, making sure that people in different places feel accounted for. An informed community. We have a responsibility to make sure that the news in newsfeed and in other places is what people are looking for and that it's accurate. A civically engaged community. We've been prompting people to go out and vote. And lastly, an inclusive community, making sure that everybody feels like they have a place on our platform. And you'll be hearing more and more about these initiatives as time goes on within Facebook. And I want to show you a brief video about how people and small businesses and nonprofit organizations around the world are using our tools and capabilities to make a change for good in the world.
children and what eventually their children tell to their children. But the first story are how to be human.
So many everyday citizens running in to help.
Now the feature has been designed for India, which enables individuals and blood banks to connect.
That video helps remind me why I go to work every day and why my job is really important to me. So that's enough about Facebook and our mission. Now I want to talk a little bit about the industry as a whole in terms of advertising and awareness of brands. I'm sure you guys have heard a lot about the importance of mobile over the last year and a half. This is something that we're going to continuously bring up because mobile devices have changed the way that we as human beings connect and consume content. We are talking to each other in different ways, and we are consuming content in ways that we have never consumed like this in the past. And specifically, is that connections on mobile are happening in an instant. So there's a small distance between us and our mobile phones. We are paying closer attention to what's happening on our mobile phones than any other media type that's ever existed. And because of that, it's important that you guys think about the differences of how you advertise or try and gain awareness on mobile versus other types of mediums, because the types of attention spans are different. So, for one example, we prefer visual forms of communication and expression because it helps us navigate the fast-moving world that we're in. And that's something that we've come to learn from mobile specifically. And this is in comparison to text, right? Mobile has allowed us to see more forms of visual communication than ever before. An MIT study has shown that we only actually need to see an image for 13 milliseconds for us to be able to identify what it is. So I want to do a quick experiment. I'm going to show you an image for 13 milliseconds, and I want somebody to tell me what's in that specific image. Okay, ready? Who can tell me? It was a Volkswagen camper van. Light blue. It was a little bit dinged up, right? Like a tiny bit grungy. So the reality is, if that was a list of attributes about a van, you would only have captured maybe one or half of one of those attributes. So images, the way we process images is a lot faster than the way that we're processing text. And in fact, it's 60,000 times faster than we're processing words. So thinking about how do we take that learning of how we process video versus how we process text and put that into how we're talking to the people on our platforms. And even one step further, we used to think that it took us 300 milliseconds to process a thought, and now we see that it only takes 30 milliseconds to process a thought. And looking at reading speeds, you can read at about 300 words per minute, but actually, if you needed to, you could read at about 500 words per minute. And you'll see what I'm getting to with all of these different statistics that I'm bringing up. So take a look at this example. It's on a mobile phone, and I'm gonna show you a series of words in an animated type of way. And I want you to try and keep up with the reading of them. So the acceleration of how we're reading words and how we're processing video wasn't driven by mobile. It wasn't driven by us. It wasn't driven by video. This is just a great combination that we're realizing works well together for people to process information better. So I wanted to frame that because a lot of what we're going to talk about today is how you use text, how you integrate that with video, because we have seen that movement, when you use movement on our platforms in your visuals, it can be a lot more effective when you're communicating your messages. So the next thing I'm going to talk about is how Facebook works. I'm going to give a really baseline understanding of how our newsfeed is actually working to show different content that people are trying to promote. The first thing is, and I'm sure you guys are familiar with this in your own feeds, is that everything competes with everything. Your nonprofit is competing with your best friend's wedding pictures, with that burger shop across the street, with the viral dog video that your friends are sharing all day long that I love to watch. And the way you have to think about your branding and your drive for awareness is that you're not just competing with other nonprofits around you or other NGOs. You're competing with everything else in feed. Those friends and family pictures, those burger pictures. So you want to be creating content that's really going to cut through all of that competition. So the goal of newsfeed is really to show people the stories that matter to them most. We're trying to create a personalized environment for people so when they open newsfeed, they'll care about what they're seeing. And I'm sure if you sit next to somebody and you guys compare newsfeeds, they will be drastically different. So why? What makes them drastically different? I'm going to show you three ways that we prioritize which stories to show people in newsfeed. So the first one is, who is posting that material? So if you like a person's posts a lot or a page's posts a lot, that's going to continuously show up more in your feed because we are looking at who posted, what you're liking, commenting, and sharing, and trying to show you more of that. The second aspect is interaction with the posts. So people liking, commenting, and sharing a post is going to bring it more and more up within newsfeed because we're seeing that people are interacting well with it, there's positive engagement, so we want to show it to more people. And lastly is the type of content. If you interact with videos a lot and you watch tons and tons of videos in your newsfeed, we're going to show you more videos. If you don't watch videos, but maybe you look at a lot of pictures, we'll show you more pictures in your newsfeed. So keep in mind, it's who posted it, what are the interactions with the posts, and the type of content. So what does this mean for you? The reality is because we are creating personalized and relevant news feeds, posts that are appealing to people's identities and their emotions are the ones that are becoming more prevalent in their news feeds and more relevant to them. And this makes Facebook and Instagram a really good place for nonprofits to be trying to get people's attention, trying to grow awareness, because this is a personalized place that you look at in the morning and when you're going to bed at night. You guys are not the only one that does it. I'm always on my phone. So thinking about it in this way is really important. Okay. So we've talked a little bit about what Facebook and Instagram does with the newsfeed, how our strategy aligns with this. Let's talk a little bit about your strategy for Facebook and Instagram, because we want to give you guys insight into where to start. There's a lot of different things that you can do. We want to give you some sort of idea of what that path can look like. The number one thing that I want to emphasize today is the importance of creating a strategy in general. Before you spend on a social team, which would be crazy, before you go into the platform and try to start launching content, you wanna think about what does your strategy look like for your nonprofit? And what we wanna recommend is building a strategy based on your mission. So what do I mean by that? There could be a lot of ways that you build a strategy for our platforms. For example, a lot of people build strategies to get a lot of likes and a lot of comments and a lot of shares, which is great. But what are those likes, comments, and shares really doing for your business? What are they really doing to drive your goals? You can post thousands of cat and dog pictures that I will like all the time, but does that mean I'm actually gonna take any action downstream after I see that content? So we wanna help you guys, and I talk to advertisers about this all the time. You want to be driving real business outcomes. While likes, comments, and shares are great and they signal that people are interested, they don't necessarily drive the outcome that you need for your business and for your day-to-day strategy of your organization. So I want to talk a little bit about, there's four things that are good to think about before you dive in to build that strategy. These might seem obvious, but I like to talk about them because sometimes people dive in without thinking about some of this. The first one is, what is your goal? You can have numerous goals, but if you can outline them more concretely, this will help you understand what you should prioritize in terms of the content that you post and how you post it. So, are you trying to raise general awareness? Are you going for a long-term growth strategy of your community? Or are you doing a more short action type of strategy? You want to drive people to an event immediately. So thinking about the different options that you have and then aligning each of those goals to its own audience, to its own type of strategy that you can actually measure. And I'm gonna give you guys an example at the end of like using these different four elements. The second one is, what audience do you wanna reach? So you have the option to reach people through their demographics, people like millennials, single dads, married people. You can also target people based on interests, people that like dogs, people that are sports fans, maybe they're interested in charitable giving. So you can get pretty granular in terms of what kind of people you can reach with your specific advertising. And thinking about, with your specific goals, how does your audience change? Maybe you target one sort of audience for growing awareness, and then you want to be targeting different people to be giving donations. You don't need a blanket strategy, audience strategy for all of your initiatives. The third one is thinking about what stories are going to resonate with this group, right? So is your audience really analytical? Do they gravitate more towards news? Are they more of a funny type of crowd where they would resonate with humor that you could put inside of your content? So thinking about the different stories that you could tell to these specific audiences, all aligning back to that one singular goal that you've defined at the beginning. And something to add here, you may not know this. There's an opportunity to do market research about what the people in your community like, and we also have a variety of audience tools that can help you better understand what your audience might be interested in, and then you can craft content to help gravitate more towards their interests. And then last but not least, how do you measure success? How do you know that what you've posted and what your strategy has been doing is actually yielding results? There are a variety of metrics that you can look at to help you guide you to that answer. So maybe you look at reach. Maybe you look at how many people see your posts. People seeing your posts is still an awareness play and getting people to better know your brand in the community. The engagement rate, while I said likes, comments, and shares might not be your sole strategy, they're still important. You still want to see who's been sharing, who's been engaging. Link clicks. Maybe you're driving people off-site to a website. Maybe you're driving them for more information there, or maybe to donate. Looking at link clicks is a really good, informative way to see how many people are interested enough to go off-site to learn more about your organization. And then lastly, maybe you're asking for donations. Maybe you're trying to get people to sign up for an event. Those are what we would call conversions. People are actually taking an action that you want them to. So measuring that, which would probably be the first thing that you would want to do. And so here's just an example of how we would recommend somebody go about building that strategy. So the example is inspire global attention as the mission, inspire global attention and action around climate change. So that's the top line mission. For Facebook and Instagram, they have two goals right now. Raise awareness among 1 million young people in Australia about the effects of rising ocean temperatures, and then collect 100,000 petition signatures to introduce a climate change bill. Say those are their two goals. They've split those out. They've given each of those a unique target audience. One is coastal areas age 13 to 35 with an environmental interest. And you can see the demographics change for the second target audience based on the goal. Parents of children 0 to 15, maybe the location is different. And then the metrics that they're going to look at. How frequently are they going to look at it? Are they looking at a weekly basis, on a monthly basis? So even if you're not sure where to start, this is a good way to outline what you're trying to do and making sure that everything is aligning back to your mission. Because in the end, anything that you do on our platforms, you want it to drive some sort of outcome for the organization as opposed to just posting pictures and videos because you think they're nice. So here you can actually measure, understand who you're targeting, build goals that all line back to your mission. Okay, now we're going to talk about the tools and products that you can leverage on our platforms. We've talked about the strategy that you can use. How could you execute against these? So we have a variety of products and tools, some you might be familiar with, some you might not be. So the top three, you know, you have your pages, which I'll talk about in a second, and we'll break down each of these. Page insights, ads. We won't go into ads, but if you guys have more questions, I'm happy to answer outside after. Then you have groups, events, fundraisers, workplace, and your creative. So it's a lot of different products that you can use. So let's look at each one, double click in each one, and see what you would use each of these for. So the first one, pages. Pages is the home of your nonprofit. It's the home of your organization. This is where people can come if they want to know more, if they want to maybe donate, you can put a button on there. And you can optimize each section to enhance your presence in the way you want to. You can add a cover photo, you can add a profile photo. There's an invite tool where people can invite more people. This is the main presence, and this is where you would post your content from. So what can you do from a page? So when you go into what we call like the composer, like if you're going to create a post, these are the options that you have. You could share a photo or video, you could advertise, you could do a live video from your page, which means it's in real time that you're filming from an iPhone or a camera. You can get phone calls if people want to call and you have a number available with somebody behind it. You can get messages if you're familiar with Facebook Messenger. I'll talk about that in a little bit, but people can message you. You can answer back with any questions they might have. Creating an event, creating an offer might be a little less applicable. Write a note to your audience, and then create a product. I wouldn't worry about for now. Page insights, this is something that you can do through your page. I'm gonna spend some time over here. This is a really interesting tool. What it allows you to do is you can look into more about your audience from your page. So what it shows you, it can show you the reach of your page, what the engagement rate of the people on your page, what that looks like, how many click-throughs there have been, signups, donations, and then you can export that data if you want to analyze it over time. So we allow you to get a more granular and high-level view of the people that are coming through your page. And more specifically, if you want to click the People tab, we can show you more about the demographics of the people that like your page. So the age, the gender, where they're located. This is really helpful if you need more insight into the kinds of people that are coming to like your page and that are showing interest in your organization. How many of you guys have used Page Insights? Okay, amazing. So the second thing I'm gonna talk about is Audience Insights. How many of you guys have used this? Okay, a little less. So this tool, it's not through your page. It's at facebook.com/ads/audience_insights. You can find it right here. And it does something similar to what Page Insights does, but it's a little bit different. So there's two options that you have when you go to Audience Insights. You can choose to analyze your page likes, again, like you can do in Page Insights, but it shows you different information. when you choose to look at people who like your page, it shows you what kind of events they're paying attention to, what kind of other pages they like. It gives you more insight into their interests and things that you could use to build content around. So for example, maybe you put people connected to your page and you saw that a lot of people were connected to pages about, I don't have a good example, about cooking or something that is similar among each other. Then you can use that interest to try and draw more people in with the content that you post. So we're trying to give you a snippet into the types of people that are interested in your community. The other option that you have is you can input age, gender, location, and interests of the whole Facebook population. So if you want to see if the interest, the charitable giving interest, people that are interested in that, what they look like as a demographic, you could tap into that too and take those insights and integrate that into the types of content that you share. So it is a really valuable tool that a lot of people make use of. The next is groups. Many of you guys are probably part of groups. Groups let you create a very specific community of people who get to interact directly with each other. You know, maybe you use this for exclusive updates. It's good for smaller groups, for staff possibly, for volunteers. Think about ways that you could integrate these groups into your strategy to make it for easier coordination through comments, through collaboration on documents, etc. You can see here in a group, you can add documents now. And also, it's important to note, they can be set to open, closed, or secret, so that people won't be able to find them if they search them. Events. Events really help you organize supporters. So you can create an event, you can share it, other people can share it, and these are things for more finite dates and time. So if something's happening on Saturday, you can create an event for it, share it on your page, and then other people can share it as well. I think events, as time goes on too, have become more and more sophisticated. And I think this is a way to really capture not only interest, but also over time, who's actually coming to those events. Fundraising tools. So we've been evolving these over time as well. There's two current ways to fundraise on Facebook. So donations can be made directly on Facebook, so through an actual fundraising type of event, which I'll talk about in a little bit, or by using a button to send people to the website of your choice. So if you guys can't fundraise on Facebook directly, you're able to send people with a Donate Now button, and then you can tell people more on a dedicated fundraiser page about the initiative. And then live. How many of you guys have used live? Oh, good, a lot of you. Have you seen success with it? Sort of? Okay. Well, live allows you to live stream whatever's happening at a specific time with your organization. I think the important thing with live, if you want to be getting people to tune in at the exact time, is the promotion of it, right? So making sure that people understand when it is, maybe creating an event telling people when it is so that they can tune in. But the reality is, people are busy. And if it lives on your page, they still might be going back and tuning into it later. But it is a really special way to give people that kind of backstage idea of what's going on without actually not being there. So experimenting with this could be really valuable. And now you can add a donate button to your live videos to collect donations while they're happening as well. And then lastly, being able to manage your page on the go. A lot of people think it's hard to manage your page from desktop consistently. There's an amazing app that you can download. It allows you to check notifications. You can message people back. It's really dynamic and allows you to do almost everything that you can do on a desktop while you're on the go. So I would encourage downloading that if you use your page a lot. Okay. So now I'm going to get a little bit more into our best practices and recommendations of how we talk about promoting content, bringing people through the journey that you're trying to take them on through Facebook and Instagram. So supporter journeys, what do we mean by that? To help you build a community of committed supporters, you don't just want to immediately ask them for donations or immediately be asking them for things back when they don't know who you are, they don't know who your organization is. So we like to think about it in a journey type of way. So starting with raising awareness, so people starting to learn who you are, what you're about, why they should care, onto how you activate your supporters, where people are starting to share, maybe pledge or take an action when you ask them to. And then the last stop is maybe raising funds. So the people that are contributing to your growth, people that you can count on to engage their friends in your content, that sort of thing. So I'm going to take you through each of these stages and what we would recommend. So the first one is raising awareness. Most people generally will start with trying to grow and build their baseline community. And even if you're halfway through this strategy and you guys are thinking, oh no, we have to go back to the beginning, it's not necessarily the case. You can continue to raise awareness while you're activating supporters. There's always time for different parts of the journey. So let's start with raise awareness. I think something that you guys can agree with is that in this stage, it's really important to grab people's attention. They need to notice through that everything competes with everything feed. They need to notice your content enough to be interested to click to your page or to click to your website. So I'm going to talk about the best ways to grab people's attention in newsfeed. And when I say newsfeed, I also mean an Instagram feed as well. So the first one is finding your voice. If you guys have created any marketing material, any email material, I'm sure you've talked about what kind of tone you want to be using, how you want to be talking to people. What we see with Facebook, what tends to work well, is more conversational types of tones. If you think people will resonate with humor, bringing that into the mix, more friendly, authentic types of communication. And something that someone mentioned once that I thought was really poignant is if you could think of what celebrity would represent your organization and how they would speak on a day-to-day basis. So for example, like if you're lighthearted and caring like Ellen DeGeneres, how would she speak consistently in that same tone of voice? Or Morgan Freeman, who's very serious and like deep voice. You want to bring that back to people day in and day out in the same way. You don't want there to be Ellen DeGeneres on Monday and Morgan Freeman on Friday. You want them to get the same tone and feel from your organization consistently. And that allows them to build trust with you as well, that they understand what you're trying to communicate. The next one is being authentic. So this is a great place for you to humanize your organization to the people that could support you. So some examples that we talk about is sharing personal stories that showcase people's experience. Something I liked was acknowledging the ups and downs of your cause. What type of journey have you gone through to get where you are today? And engaging in dialogue with supporters. So when people comment on your content, are you writing them back? Are you having legitimate conversation with the community that you're trying to engage? So thinking about ways to do that and how you can come across as the authentic organization that you are. The next one is using compelling visuals. So this is talking about photos, but in particular, we see that the unbranded imagery and the more informal imagery is what works the best in feed. And also, if you're putting statistics or any sort of text on top of the imagery, try to make it more dynamic. And I'll show you a couple of ways to do that in the creative section. And we highly recommend to design images with no more than 20% text on them. So in the advertising side, you actually can't. You will be penalized delivery-wise if you run more than 20% text. And that's because it's a better experience for people in feed if they're not getting bombarded with a lot of text over the imagery. If I think about my own feed, I would prefer less text over the images. The next one is using videos. We talked about videos at the beginning. Video is growing massively across our platforms, and it's growing quickly too. So how can you incorporate more video into your content strategy? These are some of our best practices in terms of creative considerations. Keep in mind, videos will autoplay. So drawing people in the first 3 to 5 seconds is really important for capturing attention. We call it the 3-second audition. So is somebody gonna stop within the first 3 seconds of the video that you're showing? The next one is the importance of not depending on sound. We say design for sound off, but delight with sound on. So make sure that if your video has sounds, that you use subtitles, and if they turn the sound on, that it's super additive, that they're going the extra mile to actually hear what's going on, that they're rewarded for that. In terms of uploading directly to Facebook, we always recommend you natively upload your video to Facebook as opposed to posting a link for somebody to drive to that video. And then lastly, we have a lot of different emerging formats. Like I mentioned, Facebook Live. We also have 360 videos. Those are a little bit more complex, but we are working a lot in the video space given its importance in the industry and how much people are resonating with it. Another question that we get, how often do you post? Should I be posting every day? Should I be posting every month? If we could give you a recommendation, and you're new to social media, we would say to be posting 2 to 3 times a week. I think what I would recommend you to be most careful of is that you're not posting too much. If you're posting once every day, you might be bombarding people within their feed, so keeping it on the lighter side could be helpful. And you can use Page Insights to see what frequency of posting is resulting in the number of people reached. So you can look by post to understand maybe what time of day, how many people is it reaching, and use that to inform your strategy in the future. Going back to what we talked about, having conversation, I think what's so unique about Facebook and Instagram is the ability to talk directly with your community. So some things to keep in mind, when people comment on your content, like it, comment back. Think about encouraging feedback in the posts so that you can create a dialogue between the people that are interested in that content. If there's questions being asked, you want to reply to that. Another important, if a sensitive conversation arises, maybe bring that over to direct messages so that that's not happening within the public forum of the commenting. And make sure that if you are monitoring, that you want to be hiding some of the inappropriate or maybe antagonistic posts that you might get. And then responding to messages. So do any of you guys use Messenger through your page? Okay, good portion of you. So what's important here is that if you are using Messenger and you're not responding immediately, that you want to be setting expectations with the person messaging you. So there's things like away messages that you can put on to tell somebody that you will get back to them in X amount of time. If they message you expecting an answer and they don't get one, it can be a bad experience. I know myself, if I message a page and they don't message me back and I'm like, ugh, need to talk to somebody over there. So make sure that you're setting the right expectations if you talk about using Messenger in any of your content or in your comment threads. Okay, the next one is in the support journey is activating supporters. So how do you move from the raise awareness phase to the next phase of activation? The first one is determine the actions you need people to take, right? So it's easy to just post content and expect people to understand what you want them to do, but you need to tell people a lot of times, I would like you to share this post with your friend, or please sign this pledge. Sharing a link that might seem intuitive isn't as helpful as directly asking for what you are wanting. So thinking about these different examples. And craft those examples to be compelling, right? Asking the right people. So making it more relevant instead of asking an entire audience, asking the most relevant people that might be more willing to take that action. Another one is creating urgency. So it's easy to ask for something and expect that people will do it. But if you give them a deadline or let them know that there's something coming that you want to prepare for, letting them know that there's a sense of urgency will help them understand more and likely be more willing to act. Making it easy to do. The fewer the clicks that people have, the more likely that they will convert. So a lot of times there might be content saying, hey, please go sign this pledge. And they're really interested and they click off to the website, and then there's 10 more consecutive clicks after that first click. And they drop off on the second click because they don't have time. So eliminating that barrier to somebody converting by monitoring what that journey looks like after you ask them to take that action is really important too. And if you think about it in this way, of what that looks like kind of in a timeline, the first is you present the problem, you give people the action to take, and then you show the impact of what that action will actually look like in play. And recruiting committed volunteers. I think this is probably one of the most important ones as well. Making sure that you have allies. So when you post content like this, and when people that care about your organization see it, you can count on them to share, or you can count on them to be the ally of people to make sure other people around them know that it's important. And using direct messages when you need help, using Facebook groups is a really great way. Maybe creating a Facebook group of your most active supporters, letting them know when you're gonna post some content that's gonna be really important so that they're prepared when it comes out to be that supporting mechanism for you. And lastly is raising funds. So we talked a little bit about the different tools that you can use. But in that last step of the journey, as people become more of the aware of the problem you're trying to impact, they'll be more inclined to help you on that last stage. And the tools that we have are, like I said before, you can create a post with a donate button directly on it. You could create an actual fundraiser where there's a time period and a goal with it, and then you can use live if you want, and people can donate in that as well. Some tips for asking for donations, just some thought starters, creating a theme, creating tangible outcomes, like very specifically, where is this money going, using compelling visuals like we talked about, and also ensuring that you're celebrating results along the way. So maybe you haven't hit your whole goal, but ensuring that you're posting content about where you're at in terms of that process. Okay, great. So those are our tips in terms of the supporter journeys. The last thing I'm gonna talk about, and to me is a really interesting part of content, is the creative side. A lot of times we hear from people that they're really limited on resources, which is completely understandable, and they don't have the budget to do something really creative like some of the stuff that they see in Phoebe, or they're not confident in their creative ability. I'm not a creative director. Totally understand those things. And it can be really intimidating when you see some really great creative on the platform and understand how you can make that work for yourself. So I want to talk a little bit about some suggestions that we have in terms of creativity and building for mobile specifically. I think that's where some of the intimidation can come from, is that it's a newer platform and you do want to build specifically for that mobile screen as opposed to desktop like you've done in the past. So the biggest recommendation that we have is there are a lot of amazing creative apps out there in the App Store. Some are Facebook apps, but a lot of them are also external apps that we're going to show you some recommendations of what you can use and what they can produce in terms of creative images and videos. So here's just one example, is something you think you might be capable of. It's a really great image, good lighting, but how can you integrate more of something that's going to catch people's attention and feed? So this might be a little bit overboard, but here's just an example of how you can add more types of video and visual content to grab people's attention in that first 3 seconds. Again, that is an aggressive example, but I'm gonna show you a couple other ones that maybe aren't as intense, but how could you overlay text? How could you add slight movement that it's going to engage somebody a little bit more? So I'm gonna show you 3 apps that you guys might be familiar with some of them. The first one is Facebook Boomerang. So what it allows you to do is it shows a video for like 2 seconds and then it rewinds the video for 2 seconds. Goes forward for 2 seconds, rewinds. Again, it's not that dynamic, but it allows you to create some movement that will allow people to stop scrolling throughout their feed and see what you're actually posting about. The second one is hyperlapse, which is kind of the opposite, is where you take, ooh, it's loud, where you take a long video and speed it up so that it only happens in about 30 seconds. So if you want to convey a little bit longer of a story and you don't want to take 1 to 3 minutes of people's times, Hyperlapse is a really good app to use for that. And the last one is Facebook Slideshow. So Facebook Slideshow allows you to take individual images and stream them together into a lightweight animation like this. So it's literally, I can't play it again, but literally put your images side by side and adds a little bit of movement to them. So these are Facebook app examples. I'm gonna show you a couple of external app examples that we find to be really effective with a lot of people on our platform. The first one is Adobe Post. What it allows you to do is overlay a graphic text on top of existing imagery that you have in more creative, like popping ways. The second one allows you to add dynamic text overlays on video. So this one might be a better example of something lightweight that you could do. And these are all free. And then Replay is like Facebook Slideshow, but it allows you to also take videos and string them into a lightweight animation. Facebook Slideshow is just pictures. Facebook Replay is also videos. Let me show you this. And it also allows you to stream music over it as well. The next one, something we hear a lot is that people are using stock photography, which is great, but how do you make it a little bit more like your brand? How do you make it not seem like it could be coming from any brand? There's different ways, like with the apps we just talked about, that you can add a lightweight type of logo on top of a box or things that you can make it feel more like your brand. So stock imagery is fine when you integrate it with other types of apps that you can make it more personal. Another example, just grabbing photos from your website like we talked about with Facebook Slideshow. You may not have products, but even taking pictures like this and integrating them into like a little bit different of a style of picture to make it really pop in the feed once people see it. Another one is stop motion. So you guys might have seen this on Instagram before. It allows you to basically do things in like an animated type of way and make it a little bit more dynamic with what you're showing. So I'm gonna show a slide of, it might be a little bit hard to see. You're welcome to take a picture. These are the top 10 creative apps that Facebook Creative Shop recommends that you tap into. So we have photo editing, and if you want to come up and take it, totally fine. There's photo editing by Snapseed and Over, some GIF-like videos types of apps, some video editing types of apps, and then photo to video types of apps. We recommend these to all of our advertisers. It can be very expensive to produce good creative, and these are really nice, lightweight ways that you can take your images that you already have and overlay on them. Okay, so did everyone get a good pick?
When we get slides, can we see slides
afterwards? Yeah, I think so. I think I can share the slides. Okay, the last thing I want to talk about, you guys have been great. There's 4 not like nonprofit specific support resources I would recommend The first one is our Ads Help Center. So it is called Ads Help Center, but there's also things that are not ad specific that you can go and find for troubleshooting, things you may not understand how to set up on your page. It's actually part of the Blueprint team, and they have a lot of really good content that you can use for questions. Then there's our nonprofit website. It's an education site specifically for you, nonprofits.fb.com. Then Blueprint, which I talked about, is my team. You can go for more training tools, take modularized courses. There's a lot of different activities that you can take on there as well. And then lastly, we do have a nonprofits on Facebook page that you can visit for more tips and tricks that they constantly update. So thank you guys so much. I'm gonna be around for about an hour, hour and a half. You can ask me any question. Hopefully I know the answer, but I'll be at the Workplace by Facebook booth and would love for you to come by. So thank you guys so much. Thank you.